Among the rocks and boulders on the Greek island of Naxos lie enormous unfinished statues. The work seems to have been abandoned or aborted before the features became clearly recognizable. And when something is left unfinished like this, it often gives us a clear picture of the way in which the work was performed.
Well, it's easy to see from this statue that the Greek sculptors of the 7th century gradually formed an overall image of the entire figure, working on the whole block simultaneously, so that no one part was allowed to reach a finished state before any other. The block would have been hacked from the marble quarry up there on the hillside, and then, using a sort of punch drill, which would have left these dimpled marks here on the stone, they would have blocked in the broad features, forming this vague cleft between the legs, this long, shallow furrow where the arm would eventually be, and the faceless lump of the head. Then, when these landmarks were established, and only then, they would allow the next stage of refinement to begin. The legs would have been separated, the arm would have been freed from the torso, and the facial features would have been inscribed. And so, gradually, working stage by stage, a perfect human figure would have emerged from what was previously shapeless marble.
Those statues must have provided an intriguing metaphorical answer to a question that human beings have always been asking themselves. How does man acquire his shape? And how does he manage to repeat it generation after generation? Aristotle insisted that the development and emergence of this shape was the result of something rather like sculpture, and that form was gradually imposed on shapeless substance. For him, the formless substance was provided by menstrual blood, whereas the shaping idea was contained in the sperm. It's quite clear from this that Aristotle's view of the creation and reproduction of man was drawn from his experience of art, craft, and manufacture. For him, it was impossible to explain how things came to be without referring to the way in which man himself shaped and ordered the world around him. Man finds raw materials in the rough substances of the inanimate world. And by imposing his will and his ideas on those materials, he renders the images of his own mind into a concrete form.
Now, this idea about the origin and growth of the fetus was called the theory of epigenesis. It insisted that living things came into existence from a shapeless substance, that none of the parts, none of the organs or limbs were in existence before the shaping process actually began. Now, there was an alternative, less common view in antiquity, which argued that some of the parts were already in existence before the seminal craftsman began his work, and that the process of development was largely a matter of bringing together prefabricated units and then enlarging the whole kit. Well, by the 16th century, both of these views had their supporters and advocates. But the work of William Harvey in the middle of the 17th century gave the theory of epigenesis a whole new lease of life. Now, when Harvey proved that the blood moved round the human body in an endless circle, and that the heart received all that it had sent forth, he was, in one sense, reviving one of the most influential and important ideas in European antiquity. It was an idea as old as Plato, and probably a good deal older than that. The idea was that all things in nature described great circles of one sort or another. The sun and the moon rose and fell beneath the horizon, appearing and reappearing every 24 hours. The heavens revolved in their vault. The seasons repeated themselves year after year. The clouds poured their rain onto the earth, which then gave it back to the heavens in the form of vapor. So, it seemed that nature spent and replenished herself with majestic regularity. And since man was often regarded as a small-scale model of the cosmos, a microcosm, his own natural processes were thought to echo and repeat these huge circular tendencies. Well, Harvey was fascinated by this metaphor, and in the case of the heart, he turned it into a hard, quantitative theory, logically argued with modern experimental proofs. It's not surprising, therefore, that once he'd solved the problem of the circulation of the blood, he turned his attention to one of the other great rotations in nature. Like many before him, Harvey had found himself asking how it was that reproduction ensured the perpetuity of fading things. And even while he was investigating the heart, Harvey spent hours examining incubated eggs and examining the chick at each stage. As the physician to Charles I, he'd been given access to the Royal Hunting Park, and he opened and examined the wombs of pregnant deer. Well, shortly before the end of his life, he published all these embryological observations in his great work on the generation of animals. Now here, he insisted that everything arose from the egg. In fact, you can see this summarized in this rather beautiful frontispiece, where the deity holds a Pandora's box from which all living organisms are being spilled. And on the box, there's the little motto, Ex Ovo Omnia. This idea is also symbolized in Piero della Francesca's great painting of the Madonna of the Egg. Although in the Christian notion of the Immaculate Conception, the human shape is introduced by God, for Harvey, the potential was already present in the egg itself as a spiritual possibility. In fact, as far as Harvey was concerned, the introduction of fetal shape into the womb was identical to what happened when the mind itself formed an idea. After all, both events are called conceptions, and both are essentially immaterial. But since ideas in the brain and ideas in the womb belong to the same immaterial world, they can sometimes interfere with one another. Overwhelming experiences in the maternal imagination could thus turn aside the natural course of development and introduce monstrosities. Since antiquity, men have assumed that all sorts of picturesque monsters existed just beyond the edge of the known world. The odd thing about these monsters is that they bear no resemblance to any of the known congenital abnormalities of nature. No one has ever seen a man with one huge foot which shades him from the tropical sun. From the unexplored Indies, there were fabulous reports of people with shawl-like ears and lower lips like parasols. Men with animal heads and two faces. A whole cast of characters which repeats itself with monotonous regularity right up to Shakespeare, whose Othello entertained and wooed his bride with stories of men whose heads did grow beneath their shoulders. So it seems that as long as something could be imagined, it was more or less a guarantee that it could be realized. If something was conceivable, then there was no reason to think that it was not possible. end of the 17th century, the whole notion of a shaping spirit had become almost offensive to the new breed of scientists. The members of the Royal Society, for instance, were interested in finding material causes for material events, and they tried, wherever possible, to exclude the intervention of mental processes or anything like them. Well, if the fetus was not the realization of an idea, how did it acquire its shape? Well, the scientists of the 17th century, people like Newton and Hooke, for instance, had been extraordinarily successful in applying mechanical principles to the inanimate universe. And they were making every effort to extend this principle to living things, which up to that moment had been the province of psychic forces and magical influences. But as long as philosophers continued to insist that the primal substance of the fetus was completely shapeless, there was literally no escape from the notion of a shaping idea. The person simply had to be molded or sculpted or carpentered into existence by the hand of an invisible craftsman or something very like him. But what if the egg were already organized in some version of what it was eventually to become? Then there might be no need to introduce a psychic craftsman, except, of course, at the very outset. Well, at the end of the 17th century, more and more scientists were beginning to favor the idea that the fertilized egg was already inscribed with a miniature replica of the adult form, and that this merely had to enlarge and unfold itself, rather like the insect contained in a chrysalis. Now, this idea allowed them to visualize the process in an altogether mechanical way. There was now no need to invoke a vague shaping idea, since all that there was to be was already preformed from the outset. Now, since this idea depends on the indivisible entirety of the image or little icon, scientists, of course, had to make a choice as to which parent it was inherited from. As with the epigenetists, some said it came from the male, and some said it came from the female, just like Aristotle and Harvey. Well, with the discovery of spermatozoa, the controversy, of course, hotted up. Those who believed that the image was contained in the sperm were called animalculists, whereas those who insist that it was contained in the egg were called the ovists. Anyway, one way or the other, the belief in the existence of such an effigy was so strong by that time that scientists even managed to convince themselves that they'd seen this little effigy down a microscope. Some of them claimed that they'd actually seen a minute man huddled rather like an astronaut in the forehead hatch of the sperm. And when skeptics pointed out that they could see no such thing, these preformationists, as they were called, insisted, of course, that the image was transparent at the start. Well, the fact is, of course, that microscopes during the 18th century were so poor that the images one could get allowed one to see almost anything one wanted to. Some very awkward problems associated with the idea of preformation. After all, if everything is preformed, that must mean that the sperm and the eggs are preformed as well. And presumably, these would have to contain even smaller replicas of the generation to follow, and so on and so on. Well, for some reason, the scientists were quite willing to accept this idea. They simply assumed that on the first day of creation, Providence had made a nest of Russian dolls, one inside the other, including all the details of posterity, from the first to the last moment of recorded time. Well, in fact, they were so intoxicated by this idea that some of them went to the lengths of calculating the number of forthcoming individuals preformed in the womb of Eve. Well, that was all very well. How did you explain the unexpected appearance of abnormalities?
Unless, of course, you assume that the manufacturer had mischievously included an occasional practical joke or two. But then there was the problem of healing and the repair of parts. Some animals can even replace whole limbs when they lose them. Had Providence also anticipated all future accidents and equipped the casualties with spare parts? I mean, wouldn't it have been easier for him to have spared the effort and avoided all the forthcoming accidents in the first place? After all, he'd designed those as well. Well, by the end of the 18th century, biologists were trapped between two equally awkward and finally unacceptable alternatives. There was the mystical sculptor on the one hand, and then the ingenious miniaturist on the other, inscribing all the details of the universe. If you like, it's the cosmological equivalent of the theory of continuous creation of the universe, or the Big Bang theory. Although in this case, I suppose you'd have to say it was the small bang. Well, the trouble with these two theories is that they both presuppose a picture of what is to be, a recognizably visual image of the final form, either in the mind of the phantom sculptor or else preformed in the living material. There's really no need, though, for the specification to look like the end product. There are many examples where the instructions have no resemblance to the final form. Thank you. Now, here's an interesting case in point. If I want to reconstitute a melody, I can do it either by reading it off a page of sheet music, actually I couldn't, or by converting the notes into a pattern of perforations on what is, to all intents and purposes, a large punch tape. As long as I've got a machine which can logically transform these instructions into the movements of the keyboard, then I can have the Warsaw Concerto. Abstract patterns need not only produce melodies. Almost anything can be made from a punched series of holes. Instructions cast in exactly the same form, a pattern of perforations on a punched tape, can prompt the manufacture of a three-dimensional form. The holes on this tape are converted into the movements of a cutting edge. And although the tape bears no resemblance to the final product, it logically predetermines it. What this does is to ensure accuracy and, above all, consistent repeatability. Industrial weaving uses the same principle. These plastic pegs are arranged in an abstract pattern which trip the levers of the loom, forcing it to make a well-formed glove, which will eventually fit snugly around the human hand. Here's another one. A linear sequence of perforations is fed into a computer, which will translate them into a familiar picture. Of course, this sort of abstract programming forms the basis of modern industrial technology. Although the idea of a linear code was already clearly recognized by the end of the 18th century, and if embryologists had drawn an analogy with Jacquard looms like this, which were in use at the start of the Industrial Revolution, the controversy between preformation and epigenetics might have been resolved much earlier. And once again, the program takes the form of a binary code. At each location on the card, there either is a perforation or there isn't. And when that card is pressed against an array of rods, the pattern is logically transformed into an orderly series of weaving actions. Recognizable melody from a carefully planted forest of metal pegs. In all these machines, the material on which the instructions are written is absolutely irrelevant. So, as if I hadn't already made my point, you can see that there is an alternative way of recreating or reproducing a shape or a melody. It can be done by instruction rather than illustration, by factors rather than pictures. Well, in the same way, the specifications for making a human being can take a form which bears no resemblance whatever to the final product. However, this simply pushes the problem one stage back. The instructions may not take the form of a picture, but they still have to assume some material form. Well, where are they to be found? And what form do they take? And what is it exactly that executes the orders? Where is the human pianola roll? And what's the equivalent of all those punched tape holes? For me, the first glimpse into this problem came here, on a small island on the west coast of Scotland. I first came to Millport, which is in the Clyde estuary, about 25 years ago. I used to come here once a year with a biology class from school. We used to spend about 2 or 3 weeks in the spring of every year in order to do marine biology at a small 19th century marine station. We used to collect animals on the seashore, learn their names and dissect them. It was, in a way, a form of biology which has almost vanished now. It was almost a 19th century form of biology. The interest in structure, in classification, what was called taxonomy. And it was that we spent our time learning here on the seashore at Millport. The sea urchins came in from the deep water to spawn on the rocky shore by the biological station. and we used to collect them as they made perfect models for watching the process of fertilization and development back in the lab. After cracking open the shells, it was possible to identify the male and the female, and by pressing lightly on the roe, we could get the creatures to shed their eggs into jars of seawater. The male could be milked in the same way for its sperm. After this, we drew up a small drop of sperm and dropped it into a dish. Then we added the eggs and gently mixed them together. These experiments were no different from the ones which were done by the embryologists in the middle of the 19th century. A small drop of the mixture was then put on a microscope slide. Here we were seeing something which neither Aristotle nor Harvey had been able to visualize. A single cell surrounded by a fluttering halo of sperm, only one of which would eventually succeed in piercing the membrane of the egg and fertilizing it. Watching hour after hour, often far into the night, we recorded the orderly events which followed. The cells began to divide. First into two. These two then divided in their turn to give four. Quartet then repeated the process, and on it went, until the unfavorable conditions in the lab brought development to a standstill.
By the end of the 19th century, scientists all knew that living things, plants or animals, were made of cells. It wasn't simply that they included cells, they were actually constituted by them. And they knew that this republic of cells had been called into existence by the successive division of a single primordial cell, which was itself the result of fertilization, as we've just seen. However, it's not simply a question of cellular multiplication. By the time the little embryo becomes that little blackberry, something rather more complicated begins to happen. The cells also begin to migrate. You get little scrolls and dimples, little grooves and furls, which form the outlines of what will eventually be the adult organs. Now, since this process of multiplication and remodeling takes its origin from a single primordial cell, the obvious question is, where in that cell are the instructions for the process housed? When you look at those cells under the microscope, they look quite homogeneous, rather like ground glass, in fact. But if you stain them with aniline dyes, you can immediately see that cells are not nearly as homogeneous as they look in life. There's a darkly staining nucleus. Well, now, by the middle of the 19th century, scientists recognized that just as cells were a consistent feature of every living creature, so nuclei were a consistent feature of every living cell. And since this nucleus seemed to take the initiative in cell division, scientists quite naturally began to suspect that this might be the place where the instructions were housed. Well, as microscopes improved, the image of the nucleus became clearer and clearer. And it became apparent at the same time that whatever form these genetic instructions took, they certainly weren't in the form of a pictorial replica or an icon of the adult form. What they did find was that the nucleus had inside it a series of little ribbons. And since these ribbons took up stain rather vividly, they called them chromosomes. Well, the fact that these little ribbons or chromosomes were so carefully reduplicated, the fact that they were shared out so accurately at each cell division, eventually convinced scientists that these might be the structures on which the genetic instructions were inscribed. But of course, the idea of an inscription presupposes the existence of a script. What form did this script take? What was it written in, or on, for that matter?
In an age of acronyms and initials, this little trio of letters is almost as well known as NATO, IBM, and EEC. And since Jim Watson's famous book on the subject, it's now well known, of course, that the substance takes the form of a double helix or a spiral. In fact, the achievements of the scientists who elucidated this form have been so widely publicized in newspaper articles and books that somehow it's the spiral as such which has lodged in the public imagination. The form is so eloquent that there's now a widespread impression that it's the seductive curves of the spiral itself which conveys the essential hereditary information. But as far as the genetic instructions themselves are concerned, the spiral shape as such is irrelevant. In fact, you could unwind it and it would still convey the same information. Because what this ribbon does is to carry a message. And the message is written in an alphabet which has four characters or letters. Now, our alphabet has 26 characters. But of course there are hundreds and thousands of words and an infinite series of sentences which can be composed. When Shakespeare wrote his plays, he was able to write as many as he wanted to, and there was no record of his ever complaining about there being a shortage of letters. Now, in a sense, it's much easier for cells because they're not writing plays or poems. They haven't got to be original all the time. All that the instructions have to do is to convey a limited series of messages which have to be handed on reliably from one cell to the next. And the molecular biologist proved that the four-letter alphabet is more than enough to do that job. Now, when we use words like codes and instructions, it's very easy to give the impression that there's a mysterious psychic eye which reads and obeys the instructions inside the cell. And of course, if that were the case, it would simply take us right back to the mystical principles of Harvey and Aristotle. But in fact, the process is much more like a building site than a reading room. The code has a contour or a bumpy outline into which other substances can be made to fit. Once it's been manufactured, this transcript is peeled off and sent into the cell, which uses it as a linear program which guides its development. It's also possible to think of DNA as a sort of musical score, and the development which it dictates as a biological melody. Everyone knows that melodies can go wrong, and that these machines can also get it wrong through faulty scores or slipshod reading. But faults in genetic reproduction are much more complicated than badly programmed computers, or knitting machines going wrong and producing gloves with missing fingers, or misprinted musical scores. All the same, this musical parallel will help to point out the main areas where mistakes occur. Such missing or misprinted notes would produce a characteristic fault in the developmental process. The error may be the result of interpolating a whole passage of inappropriate notes. Because this fault is in the score, and the score is transcribed faithfully from generation to generation, an error like this would be hereditary. The fault may not lie in the score, though. It may be the result of inattentiveness on the part of the players. Since errors like this are obviously not in the instructions, the faults which they produce are one-offs and can't be hereditary. Well, it seems quite likely, in fact, that errors like this, on that scale, occur far more often than one might think, and that a large number of conceptions are aborted at the very earliest stage. And the fact that there's been a pregnancy at all is only recognized because there's been, well, a briefly missed period. So, as you might expect, the fate of the abnormality depends on its severity. Some can survive right into adult life, like a cleft palate, for instance, or a hare lip. whereas some only become apparent when the stress of ordinary life begins to reveal them. I suppose the best example is a hole in the heart, which may only show itself when the infant begins to exert itself after it's learned to walk and then run. Well, some of the most interesting abnormalities represent failures of the finishing process. And for that reason, they provide rather interesting and useful evidence about the way in which the program is put together. At a comparatively early stage of the development of the human head, five processes or peninsulae grow in and organize themselves around the fixed landmarks of the eyes, the nose, and the mouth. A central visor grows in from the top to form the forehead, the nose, and that funny little groove on the upper lip which is called the philtrum. At the same time, two processes grow in from the sides, underneath the eyes, to form the cheeks, the upper lip, and the hard palate. The point where these meet in the middle is marked by that funny little web that you can feel if you run your tongue inside your upper lip. Meanwhile, a sort of chin strap forms underneath to give the lower lip and the lower jaw. Now, if any of these five processes fail to grow in as a result of a sight reading error, if they fail to make their midline rendezvous, then you get a little fissure where the seam ought to be. Fortunately, it's possible to repair most of these defects either by patching the holes or by restitching the seams. So, all the errors I've mentioned so far represent arrests in development. That's to say, they're failures to complete an appointed task. And for that reason, they provide quite an interesting picture of the earlier stages of the development of the individual. But not only that, they also give a sketch, or at least a caricature, of the racial history of the species as a whole. Now, one has to be very careful how one puts this, because one can very easily give a misleading impression. In fact, during the 19th century, there were certain biologists who insisted that the development of the individual was a complete recapitulation of the evolutionary history of the species. In fact, they went so far as to say that during the course of its development, an individual actually climbed up its own evolutionary tree, passing through every one of the adult phases of its own ancestors before it finally acquired its own form. Now, this is a gross oversimplification. A developing individual does not repeat the adult stages of its ancestors, although it may reproduce some, though not all, of the embryological stages of its predecessors. Now, for instance, in the early development of a human being, you can sometimes recognize features which resemble the gills, not of adult fish, but of fish embryos. Now, the structures I'm referring to are in those little bumps immediately behind the eyes, there and there. Those little translucent stripes. Strictly speaking, they aren't even gills at the moment. Certainly not functioning gills. That's why the creature has to have those little red fronds or external gills until these slits perforate through into the throat and become the gills of the adult. As the human embryo develops, these structures, which in a fish will go on to become gills, become incorporated in strictly human organs, such as the larynx. Now, if these structures get arrested during the course of their development and prevented from assuming their laryngeal function, then one can recognize sometimes little cysts or lumps in the side of the neck. Now, this doesn't mean that the individual is turning back into a fish, or that he is a fish. It shows, in fact, how much we as a species have diverged from and advanced beyond the fish. These errors represent one of the methods whereby animal species have sometimes evolved in new and sometimes rather promising directions. Now what happens is this. Most of the invertebrates, in the course of their development, pass through an active, mobile larval stage. That is, before they settle down and assume the often rather sluggish adult form. This is what happens in animals like the sea urchin. But it also happens in a close relative of the sea urchin called the sea cucumber. Now, in a very early ancestor of the sea cucumber, something rather interesting and peculiar happened. Instead of passing on through this mobile larval stage, further development was arrested by a genetic fault, and like Peter Pan, it never grew up. It acquired the ability to breed while it was still in this infantile stage. So instead of reproducing more sea cucumbers, it reproduced a line of versatile and mobile creatures, which formed a fruitful stock for our early ancestors. Now, if this mistake had simply been a sight reading error, as opposed to a novelty which had been introduced into the genetic material itself, it would, of course, have disappeared, and we wouldn't have heard of it again. Evolution can only work if these random accidents are included in the DNA code itself, producing what we call a mutation. Now, as it happens, most mutations are disastrous, because they simply upset the status quo. But if they're small enough, and if they confer an advantage, as to say, if they give the creature a head start in the remorseless struggle for existence, then the novelty has the chance of reaching adult life. And if the creature breeds, it will, of course, hand the novelty on to the next generation, and to that extent, the species will have taken a slight turn in a new direction. Now, I'm not saying that all mutations take the form of arrests of development. There's an infinite series of novelties that can occur in the sequence of codons. But for the human species, at least, it seems quite likely that in our long ancestry, there was a moment when events took a sort of right-angle turn, producing errors which are at least analogous to the ones which we now regret and, of course, have to treat. The human species is, to some extent, the result of mistakes which arrested our development and prevented us, just in the nick of time, from assuming the somewhat unglamorous form of our primitive ancestors.